So, welcome to Dear Internet, I Made a Comic, Now What? I'm Jen Vaughn, I'm one of the moderators and on the executive committee for SPX. And today I'm going to let these guys do most of the talking, but I thought we could hit the three P's of comics making, since how many of you are selling a comic here today? Like, show of hands. Okay, like four of you. How many of you make comics online? Most of you. And how many people want to make comics online? Okay, the rest. Good. Okay. Was someone looking for the bathroom? Okay, good. Bob, could you not go here? It's like, we had to replace the carpet after last year, so. Anyway, so the three P's. Yeah, and it's...
That's one of them.
Yeah. So the first one is people. And with people, you don't have readers. You don't have people to preach about your comics, to extend your spread. You don't have collaborators to work with. The second P is persistence. As you know, comics is a lot of work. That's why we do that instead of like oil painting, because you can make like sell a $3,000 painting when only one person gets to enjoy it in like the mid-afternoon sun during a thunderstorm, where sun comes out apparently. But with comics, like if you don't do the work, it's not there in the book. And it's all about persistence, like making good stuff, coming year after year to cons, just your own like personal deadlines you put for yourself on a webcomic. It's all about persistence. And the third P is a dirty one, and it's pennies. It's about money. Because I know we're all here to do the art, and we want to sell stuff that we love and enjoy and pass it on to other people. But you also want to make some money. You want to be able to pay for your next print run. You may not be able to pay for all your health care or other bills, but you want to make enough that it's worth it, because you want to like stay bright, focused, making great comics, and not become kind of like jaded and always looking at your sales sheet and just being like, ugh, like I just need to make two more sales today. So the third one is a little dirty, I know. Some people don't like to talk about it. But we have four panelists here who have all used one or more of these three P's to their advantage, and they make great comics because of it. So I'm just going to go down the line, but that's okay.
I love P. What was the second P?
It's like persistence. Hmm. People, persistence, pennies.
Got it.
Yeah. I mean, I made it up on the plane, so I'm even like an oxygen low.
I like it.
After finding a penny on the floor.
Yeah.
Yes.
This is always the best part. Well, anyway, I'll just start talking. Matt Bors is an editorial cartoonist and editor who's launched the comment site The Nib on Medium.com in 2013. He has recently quit and kickstarted a collection of their best work, which debuts at SPX, called Eat More Comics. To his right is John Roberts, co-founder of Comixology and director of Submit and Digital Storytelling. And in the way, way back was everything from an art director at True North Advertising to the senior developer at Marvel.
What, are you stalking me?
Doing my job. Next we have Molly Ostertag, hailing from SVA, who illustrates a twice weekly webcomic called Strong Female Protagonist with Brendan Lee Mulligan, who's now also recently printed into a book. And you've also run a successful Kickstarter for the book, I'm sorry, and it's now distributed by Top Shelf.
Thanks.
And then last but not least, we have Aatmaja Pandya, cartoonist and illustrator from New York. She graduated from SVA as well, the BFA in illustration. Her current project, Travelogue, is a fantasy diary, and if you haven't seen it yet, she was new to me, it's amazing. It's one of my favorite things. It follows Nana, Adi, and a couple different beautiful characters, and it's just like beautiful, and it doesn't even matter how you read it. It's a fantasy diary focusing on quiet moments and world building. So if we could just start by going into the P's, is that okay? Or did you guys want to each do a little?
What's P?
What are you drinking? It's kind of yellow.
Yeah, I don't like that.
No. So Matt mentioned earlier today that he has worked on many projects, and none of them for longer than a year, while Molly has been working on Strong Female Protagonists for a long time and has paid off by getting a print version of the book in multiple ways. A webcomic may have been what you've always wanted to do it, but just like have it in a tactile form is amazing. So what do you think between the two of you, or all four of you, like at what moment do you say like a project is done or I need to keep pushing forward?
That's a good question. I think Strong Female Protagonist is a kind of weird example because I started in school. And just have sort of just been trucking ever since, and just like drawing 2 pages a week, and we'll probably do that for like another decade. And what makes the difference for me is that I have a collaborator, Brennan, who's my writer. And so I think having like one other person has helped me really continue it and not kind of burn out or turn to other things. So yeah, I think like, and it, to me, it feels like it's really paid off to be focusing on this one project, but, oh, sorry. Yes. Oh, you're right. yeah, I was just saying that I think for me, having a collaborator was what let me really carry on and keep up the work of doing it regularly. And it'll be finished when it's finished.
I've never done a serialized strip or an ongoing thing. So with me, it's just like, you know, I did a graphic novel, then I kickstarted my own book, then I got a part-time job with this site, Cartoon Movement, editing comics journalism, and you know, they laid me off. So, you know, that I didn't really decide to end most of my gigs, except my latest job I left, which is kind of weird because I was getting paid well and I had a job with healthcare, but they took away my budget for the nib, so I just decided to go do something else, which is I'm trying to relaunch it with another publisher. But if I don't do that, then I'll just make up something else. I'll kickstart another book or something and just keep trying to pay my bills some way.
But I do think it's really valuable, especially if you're interested in doing a serial story or long-form narrative, to, when you found that story that really works for you, to like stick with it. And sometimes it'll be hard and it won't feel like it's paying off for a while, but I think that the like emotional weight of having a story and having characters that people can read like a big chunk of pages about is just worth a lot.
I have been doing a weekly strip for 12 years, probably, just political cartoons. They're not interrelated, but that might be the main thing that I'm known for. I don't know, but you know, it's kind of hard to commit to that. But
yeah, I subscribe pretty heavily to the philosophy of like, if you're doing a comic for yourself, then just do it until it's fun, and when it stops being fun, stop. Like, there's no shame in stopping a comic you're doing with your own time and effort and sweat. Like, I had a webcomic before Travelogue for like 2 years, and I think I could have stuck with that for like 5 more years, but it was just like, it was time to move on, and it's fine. People on the internet are more forgiving than you think they are.
Which internet are you using?
I ignore a lot of it.
Thank you. I had a question also, so moving on to pennies for a little bit, about money. So, two of you have kickstarted. You use Gumroad for the Travelogue mini comic and maybe a couple other things. And then John represents Comixology, so in partner with Amazon, which is a digital storytelling and a way to get money basically for your comics by uploading. I'm wondering, like, what's made you turn to Kickstarter versus maybe trying to find a publisher, or perhaps, you know, a publisher said no, so you went to your giant audiences you have. You could just. Anybody?
I love Kickstarter, and I think that having, being able, which I, this is something I recognize that not everyone can do, but Brennan and I were able to produce this comic for a couple years without really looking for payment and just doing it as like our side project. And when we built up a certain audience, that is when I think Kickstarter, oh, don't look at this page, there's a lot of spoilers. It's like the end of an arc.
Nobody look.
if you've sort of built up that good credit on the internet of sort of being like, I've made this, you see that I've created this content already, and I just want to produce it, and I want to have it in a book that like you also internet people can own. I think that's when Kickstarter is really good, when you've sort of proven that you've got it. And we didn't actually even try really taking it to publishers, because if you think that you do have like the following and the attention to run a successful Kickstarter, in my opinion, you'll sort of make more money in the end by doing that. If you plan everything out correctly, you'll make more than you did off of royalties. And it's a really cool promotional like experience that I think having a book published by a publisher wouldn't necessarily might not be.
Yeah, I was gonna say that about the money. Like real penny talk is that there are, you know, especially I'm in editorial cartoons, and like editorial cartoon collections don't sell a lot, and they get old really fast. So, you know, the days of Pat Oliphant selling like 40 or 50,000 books of his last 2 or 3 years of comics is completely over. But you can probably make the same amount of money selling 2,500, which is what I printed up for my Kickstarter. And, you know, like the rough math is like I raised 35,000 and that paid for all the printing. And then I had, I think, 1,500 left to sell. And that's just like pure profit in my pocket, you know. A lot of which I'm getting in cash at conventions and not declaring, so I'm not paying taxes on a lot of it.
Good thing it's and on film.
Off
right?
the record.
Yes. But you know, so that adds up to more, like you're saying, more money than you're going to get from a publisher. I mean, you're going to just, unless you have a huge following, I mean, you know, you're not going to sell that many books. So I'm in favor of self-publishing, although you got to like really do some due diligence and research on it, and especially mm-hmm. like fulfillment and all that stuff can be crazy. I've seen Kickstarters can like ruin people's lives.
Oh yeah.
Like the logistics of doing all that stuff is pretty crazy.
Yeah, a lot of people when it comes to Kickstarters don't consider international shipping as part of the problem, and you can lose a lot of money shipping internationally.
But there is, I think there's, it's hard, but there is something really rewarding about putting the research in to figuring out, to knowing kind of every aspect of the book that you produced. Like, I think for future projects that aren't strong female protagonists, I want to go through publishers because it is like a lot of work, but I'm really glad that I know about the printing process, shipping, and like, I know it back to front and I can do it if I want to. And that's kind of liberating yourself from needing to be published to get, to get a physical book out there is really exciting. And it starts with like what we have mostly at SPX, which are mini comics. That's like the first thing that you can do really easily without a Kickstarter.
Plus the content of the book is totally yours, right?
Yeah.
Like you don't have to make any compromises.
Yeah, Aatmaja, you actually recently started your online store, I think back earlier this year, and you put up some books on Gumroad. And how has that helped you, would you say, in comparison to going to conventions?
I get maybe $5 from Gumroad a month. That's nice. Gets me a coffee. Gumroad is nice because this is a personal thing, but I believe in like putting all my comics online free for anyone to read, right? And I like to hope that some people want to support it financially and they can buy it through Gumroad, and some people like physical books better, so they come to conventions and buy books. So financially, conventions are a lot more lucrative. But for accessibility and getting readers comics in any way possible, like having a store and a convention presence and having it on your website and promoting it on social media, all of those help in a way.
Yeah, creating like multiple revenue streams for the same book and the mm-hmm. same like heart and story.
Because you can't promote enough. You can tweet like 16 times in a minute and someone is still going to be like, you're at this convention? What? Like, you know, so
yeah,
you can just, what is it like? Spread your tendrils, spread your roots. Is there an expression for that?
Plant your seeds?
Let your...
Tentacles?
Let them
and then suction cup the dollars.
Yeah. I do think like making it really easy for people to give you money in the way they're comfortable with is crucial. And so having a donate button, doing a Kickstarter because some people love Kickstarter, but having the book because some people love books, and like just like having a Patreon if you're into that, like there are like make it as easy and accessible and comfortable for like when someone enjoys it and has that thought like, oh, I should pay for this content. It should be like right there.
I'll try to get paid for each comic like 5 times. So my editorial cartoons run in a couple clients pay each week to run them. Then I have like a private email list that I send it out to that people pay to be on that goes out before it's published online. Then you know, maybe in a book collection, and then if you're lucky, you could sell originals of some stuff. But yeah, it's like trying to get paid as many times as possible for the amount of work that you're doing.
Wait, was that 4 times?
I don't know. I try to go for 4 or 5.
As a small or independent cartoonist, whatever, being on as many platforms as possible, getting your voice out in as many places as possible, going to where the people are is the best way to really reach people, which is one of the things that we do with Comixology and Comixology Submit, which is, put the SPX sale. Anyway, so, you know, at Comixology Submit, you know, we're this, you know, the premier platform for digital comics, and, you know, we really had this affinity for independent creators and for cartoonists, and we really wanted to be able to showcase their work, and so we came up with Comixology Submit, which is this self-service platform where any one of you in the room can go and submit a comic, and it can be up, you know, relatively quickly. We've got a lot of great stuff, like Jen's showing you right here. And one of our goals is to make everyone in the world a comic book reader. So finding people, yeah, it's a lofty goal. It's a lofty goal, but you know, I have two kids to pay college for, so I'm gonna pursue it enthusiastically. But the idea is, like, you know, how can we get your work in front of as many people as possible, and to get it in front of the people that are looking for it. So we actively promote the stuff on Comixology Submit. We do promotions. We release new books every Wednesday. We feature books. We have a newsletter specifically dedicated for independent content. We do regular sales promotions. I don't know if you guys are familiar. We've done bundles in the past where we did, like, huge bundles for $10, and people seem to really enjoy that. So if you haven't tried, checked out actually, let me ask, how many people here are familiar with Comixology? Oh, good. All right. Soft sale. All right. So yeah, so I recommend you check it out. You know, we've got some great stuff. You can go right now. There's a SPX sale to get an idea of what's out there.
Actually, John, can you kind of walk us through, like, a short timeline of how long, like, and the submit process for everyone? So, like, because it seems a little bit bigger than... it seems bigger, but it's actually very easy.
I should tell people how to do it. That's a great idea.
Can you do your job?
Yes. Yeah, do my job. You were doing it so well for me. Yeah, so if you go to submit.comixology.com, it's a self-service platform. You either log in with your pre-existing Comixology account, or you create a new one. You basically do the click-through contract, which is a 5-year non-exclusive. We take absolutely no rights, which means that you can continue to do whatever you want with it, go to publishers, you know, do Kickstarters. We've actually done digital redemptions for Kickstarters.
You fulfill?
Yes.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yes, so if you would like to, you know, instead of sending, or in addition to sending people DRM-free PDFs, we can actually work to provide codes so people can download the book on Comixology.
That's really cool.
Yeah. I'll give you my card.
All right, cool.
So you go, you enter in your publishing entity information, you enter in your series information, you enter in your what we call metadata, which is like the title, the description, the creators who worked on the book. You upload a PDF file. Now, it is a curated process, so we do review all the PDF files. Some of the stuff that we look for are making sure that the PDF file is doesn't have production issues like artifacting, pixelation. What a lot of people don't realize is that Adobe Acrobat Pro by default produces a PDF file that we can't use. So educating people on the best way to produce a PDF file so that we can have, I mean, the goal here is to present your work in the best light possible. So we want to make sure that what we have is pristine so that we can present to our readers is the best presentation of your book possible. So we work with people to make sure that happens. We release, like I said, we release new books every Wednesday. We feature a bunch of stuff. We've got great, I mean, like, An Entity Observes All Things by Box Brown is right there. We had Lou Delaquante's,
Human Star.
That's on sale this weekend, actually. The goal here is to create a really good selection of comics that we can point people to. So I'm kind of droning on here, but the last thing I want to say is we've started doing a panel at conventions, which is a recommendation panel, where people come up to us and say, this is the stuff that I like, and then we like to be able to point to people to things like, well, you would like this, you would like fresh romance, or you would like an entity observes all things, or it's like, you know, being able to say, if this is something that you like, then this is something else that you would like. And a lot of times, you know, people that are so focused with the larger companies that they don't realize. So it's great being able to introduce someone to something and see that enjoyment that they get from reading it.
Yeah, I think a lot of us here at SPX are kind of like punk rock, so Saddle Staple, Risograph Comics, but you actually have some of those on the platform, and they look great. And like that, like Blue Delaquanti's comic is up there, and it's a free web comic, but then you get, I believe, to me, the benefit of going with the man.
Well, you know,
I'm sorry.
Yeah, it's funny. I mean, this is not a not a great example, but Atomic Robo is currently putting up all their comics for free. And the books continue to sell on our platform. And they're surprised more than anyone. They're like, well, we have it up for free. Why? But people like to have it. I think it's like that collection kind of thing. And yeah, I mean, we have Charles Foreman's Revenger, which is done on a Riskograph. And it looks amazing. I mean, that book, if you haven't seen Revenger, sorry, we actually cleared out his inventory at the booth. But if you haven't seen Revenger, I highly recommend it. It's this great 80s comic style, like, you know, Punisher style, like 80s movie book, but it's done on a Riskograph and it looks great.
Yeah. I think you guys help provide a little bit more like marketing help, which is maybe something people need other than like their own audiences, or I just want to talk about a little bit of lateral networking. So a lot of you, I noticed both of you, Molly and Aatmaja, you had linked to each other on your websites, and I thought that was great. Because it's like web ring, like 1998 style, like, but it's like, but it's good because like, once you start reading something you like, sometimes you're going to find, you're like, well, what else do they, like, what, who do they know? Or like, what's something else in the same vein? And I'm wondering how conventions and coming back year after year, like how that's helped you in like building an audience through other people's readers.
Yeah, Aatmaja and I went to school together, which was nice, with a bunch of other really talented artists. But I do think that like cultivating a circle of people who have similar interests or similar styles to you, maybe they're all into webcomics or you're all kind of geared towards graphic novels. And I think I think about like allies a lot, but also they could be called friends. But like, but like professionally, it's sort of like they're your allies, in that you will sort of like recommend each other for jobs and share your work around. And I think it's great. Like it's both nice to have your own work shared, but it's also just nice. I mean, this is like a win-win. It's nice for yourself to be a part of a community of comics, but it's also good to kind of look like you're part of a community of comics and to kind of have your fans feel like they're in on this cool kind of clique of like a specific style or specific group of friends. And I think both conventions are great for finding those people, and Twitter is very, very active in the comics community.
We were very lucky because we went to art school, and right, that like kickstarts the networking process for you. If you stick with like the people you really like and admire and respect. But also, I made so many of my friends in the comics community and met so many people I respect just by doing a webcomic for 2 years. And it's kind of amazing. Like really all you need to do is put your work online and someone will read it. And a friend of that person will read it, and a friend of that person will be someone you really like, and you meet them at a convention a year later, and suddenly you're friends. Like, it definitely takes patience and time, and you have to kind of take the initiative to be friendly and outgoing and facilitate it, but like, yeah, just kind of like being on Twitter, being online.
And I think a lot of times there's an inclination to sort of try to make friends with the people you've already heard of, who are maybe a little bit further along in their career.
Yeah.
But I like sort of can't recommend highly enough like
be kind to like the people.
Yeah,
around
like
you.
Being being sort of generous and open and like understanding that your peers are going to rise with you and you're all sort of going to help each other up. And I think that is like really, really valuable.
Yeah.
And don't talk too much shit, because
don't talk
you're
shit.
Be, you're gonna
oh,
be around.
Yeah. You never do that.
Don't do it.
Don't do it.
At least not in text form.
Yes.
Online.
10 years later, they're gonna be in a position to like give you work or something.
At Twitter, this is one of my frustrations. I do a lot of promotion of the Submit content on Twitter, And it amazes me, a lot of people who don't have Twitter. Twitter is a great tool to immediately interact with your community. And one of the great things about digital comics is that we have a URL that points directly to a thing on our site that you can point people to buy and instantly get access to your work. And so I try to reach out to as many people on possible on Twitter. And so if you don't have an account and you actively want to create comics and promote comics, get one, because it's a valuable tool. And you know, like they were saying, you can reach out to creators online, cartoonists, and you know, they're all, a lot of them, for the most part, I don't want to say 100%, but for the most part, they're great. You know, they'll interact with you, they'll share secrets, you know, they'll give you advice. And creating these, like, essentially click rings or whatever, I forget what is it, you know, like where you get people to talk about your books. I mean, these are all valuable tools because you're helping to reach, you know, to branch out the work that would only go here can now like spread throughout the world because of you know, people interacting with each other.
Right, so we've got persistence and people to help avoid just like creating comics in a void, basically, because that's sort of what the internet is, to a point where, like, I'm sure some people are wondering, and we'll have questions in a minute from you guys. Some people are wondering, like, you know, how can I become successful? Whatever their, you know, whatever their measure is of that, like, is, I mean, I'm sure we're all like struggling to make rent, or you know, you make rent, but no one knows who you are, like, and people again help with that. Like, a couple of you collaborate constantly with people. Matt, you have like other cartoonists do stories for you, and Molly collaborates as well. And you think they, you said, you mentioned earlier they like help you stay on track, but like, what do they bring to you guys creatively that? Do they make it like, is it a better process, or is it someone to kind of fight against? Like, you can bring out your worst ideas and luckily, but you want to do it and they like help you shoot it down, or?
I think it depends a lot on the person and the, both on yourself and the person you're working with. But if you do find someone, my writer, Brennan, I've known him for a really long time. And so if you find someone who you personally and creatively connect with, I think like collaborating is so, so powerful. Bringing like more than just yourself to a project, and kind of like there's something cool about like bringing multiple skills. Like, I've went to school for drawing and Brennan went to school for writing. And so like we're sort of both better at that like together than one person could be. And also there's just something, even when it comes to promotion, I know that people often are kind of shy to promote their own work. Especially on the internet, it feels so much easier to promote it. Like, I can be like, strong female protagonist, the writing is amazing. And like, I can say that really honestly without, like, and sort of still be like as humble as I'm comfortable being.
I collaborated on a graphic novel with someone, but I wouldn't say that I collaborate so much as, I mean, I'm an editor, but one of the reasons I like doing that is because I'm making comics happen that aren't otherwise going to exist for the most part. I mean, some are being pitched to me and are, if I don't take them, they're gonna, you know, exist somewhere else. But a lot of them come through discussion with cartoonists about an idea they have or an idea I have that I think that they'd be good for. Because a lot of cartoonists aren't used to working with editors, you know, they're just doing their own webcomic or whatever. And there's not a lot of cartoonists that work with or for publications. So it's kind of, it was an unusual process for a lot of people I was working with, but I think like a lot of stuff that we published in the last 2 years is stuff that wouldn't have existed otherwise.
And it's stellar. But could you give us a few tips on how to like be, I don't know, you know, not polite in an email or, but you know, polite, amiable, I guess.
Oh God, I don't know.
You don't know?
Polite in an email. I don't know email etiquette.
No,
tips,
no,
but,
no. Okay,
but
no etiquette.
I would
lessons
say
here.
That I would just say that bringing in online interactions, bringing positivity to the table, really obviously, can literally never hurt you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just, you know, if you feel like ending a sentence with an exclamation point, go for it.
Yes.
And like being enthusiastic, because it's just, text is so, can be so cold, and like approaching people and sharing and just trying to network over the internet, bringing as much positivity as you feel is important.
Yeah. I guess, thinking about it, I guess I would say that, you know, I was working with a lot of different cartoonists. I mean, up to like 20 a week and more people submitting stuff. And a lot of it is, you know, some cartoonists are difficult, which isn't surprising, and the final product is worth it. But sometimes it isn't really. Like you don't have to work with anybody that you don't want to. So, you know, not being an abrasive or difficult person is sometimes very helpful for some people.
Have you had people that have applied multiple times and finally broke through? Like,
yeah.
Not gonna say who though. Okay, that's good. But that's good that they were persistent and they like kept going. And
we had someone who had, there was a comic book writer who was in the military, served in Iraq or Afghanistan, and had done, basically had created his own comic on the back of his order sheets, basically, while he was there. Unfortunately, they weren't very good as far as the art goes, but there was a really good, solid story there. There was not anything that we could really do with it. But I reached out to him and I said, look, what you have here is a great layout for a comic. So if you were to hire like a professional artist, because he was not an artist at all, if you were to hire an artist and have him embellish, like take your idea and really run with it, you could have something really powerful here. And he took that advice to heart and was like, he likes to call me out on it on Twitter. I think it was like the nicest rejection letter that he had ever received. but he did. He went out, he hired someone, he had them take his storyboards and basically turn it into a comic, and it's actually a pretty decent one.
Cool. That's beautiful. Yeah.
You had to ask me that question.
Well, how about we take a couple of questions from the crowd while you Google it on your phone?
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. And there's a couple microphones, and if you don't mind using them, just because we're videotaping this for future generations to use.
No service.
No service. That's what it's called. Okay, great.
No service.
Yes. Sorry. And the bandana.
We can hear you.
Yes. There might be a thing on the side you can...
You can just talk real loud, it's good.
Talk real loud.
Yeah.
All right, I just want to know if anyone has A, used Tumblr to promote your work, and B, if you have any suggestions for it, especially like I'm the writing half of my collaboration, so I can't fill up, I have a little time to promote, I can't fill it up with art and draw people in. So any suggestions there?
It's tough.
I don't know.
Tumblr is so reliant on images.
Yeah.
Well, you can, I mean, if you can share the art, share progress. I think Tumblr, having an active Tumblr is great. There's like a lot of people focused on there. And like having your Tumblr that's like probably like 90% your own stuff and maybe 10% like other people's things. But if you're the writer, you could even share like inspiration, like looking at like, I don't know, some costumes that I like, of photos that I thought would be cool for the comic. Like just having, like maintaining an online presence is cool and it's kind of like drops in an ocean. Like if you might feel like you're posting too much, but you're probably not.
I use Tumblr. I post my work everywhere basically. Like Tumblr, Twitter, Facebook, these are all like closed ecosystems that, you know, some people go to Facebook and some people go to Twitter to find all their stuff, and you kind of have to have a presence everywhere. And it can get exhausting. But like with Tumblr, I kind of don't get how it works exactly. I have what I think is a large following on Tumblr, but I don't like spend time on Tumblr participating in it the way I do on Twitter. I just post my work, and you know, like she was saying, it's very image based, and it like stuff can just take off. But it's also really bad for like getting people to follow links or get anyone to come out of it, because you can post, you know, when it's time to get the pennies from all of the free readers. And you post a link to your Kickstarter, like that's not an appealing post or image, so people aren't reblogging it, and it just doesn't get around in the way a comic does. So what I'm trying to say is you really have to have a presence on every different platform that is on the level where a lot of people are using it.
Yeah, Tumblr's really good at, people like to reshare images on Tumblr, but they don't like to actually click on links. But there's one thing that you can do, so, as we found out to the audience here, there's a lot of people out here who want to make comics. They basically want to recreate the things that these people up here are doing. If you're in the process of doing that, share that information. Jason Brubaker, who does a comic called Remind, and at he was one of the first people to do a Kickstarter that raised over, I think it was over $100,000 for his first hardcover. What he found was that what brought the most traffic to his website were the tutorials on how to make comics. Because there's constantly people out there looking, how do I do this? How do I do that? And if you can talk about the process, if you can share the things that you're going through, then people who are looking to do the exact same thing that you're doing are going to find you, and then they're going to become fans, and they're going to follow you, and they're going to, and then when you do something like a Kickstarter, they're going to come to see what you're doing. Jason Brubaker actually wrote a book on how to do a successful Kickstarter that he was able to successfully sell, basically for that entire reason.
Yeah, there's something I wanted to say that's sort of an offshoot of this, but since we're talking about promoting your work online, which is in addition to just using all of the different platforms, like you got to be aware of how to use them really well. And I don't see a lot of cartoonists doing this. Like on Twitter, for instance, you can do a preview image on Twitter that you can look up the preview image sizes for all of these different platforms, and like on Twitter, you can create a graphic that displays fully in line, so you don't click on it and it doesn't expand to anything else. You just view it, and if you take the time to not just put a link to your comic, but to do that, like crop out something for every comic that fits within that, like people are going to click more. And Facebook is a whole different one. Like if you have a 6-panel comic that's one image, and you post the link on Facebook, a couple years ago, there barely used to be a preview image, and now preview images are like huge in the feed. And if it's 6-panel comic that's one image, it just like throws it up in the center, and you got like the middle of all the panels that looks like garbage. So at the NIB, we had this like semi-sophisticated social media game where, I mean, we would spend hours every day writing tweets, Facebook posts, cropping all the image, sending them to every artist that was being published, and trying to get it out. And that works a lot better than, you know, like just throwing up links. And
yeah.
And also I think sometimes comic cartoonists can be like super self-effacing, and it's like, oh, here, I did a thing. And yeah. you don't have to be like super pitchy and overconfident, but you should kind of like, you can take the time to write, you know, something that isn't too self-critical either.
Yeah.
A bit of self-promotion on my part. My Twitter handle is Johnny Storm, and then the number 0. Every Wednesday, I basically promote 5 or 6 submit titles, and I basically do. I actually created a template, because Twitter actually crops the images differently on every single platform, which drives me crazy. So I came up with a template that basically allows me to have the best chance of having the image crop correctly on whatever platform it is. But what I do is I take a panel out of the comic that I'm promoting, and then I try to include the Twitter handles of the people who worked on it, if they have one, as well as a link to the book. Now, Twitter allows you...
Which is sort of like a passive-aggressive way of being like, hey, retweet this. Come on.
Well, see, okay, so...
I'm just kidding.
No, but see, you're right, because in a lot of cases, if I don't do that, they don't think about it.
Yeah.
So it's getting cartoonists and creators to promote themselves is
I dealt with that too at the NIB, because I was like, we have to get readers. I had a lot of pressure on me to deliver readers, so you know, some cartoonists are more at ease with this than others.
Yeah.
I found,
well, it's not a natural thing, like you know, talking about yourself is not a natural thing, but anyway, the main Twitter app allows you to tweet up to 4 images at a time, with only costing the character count of one image. So what I recommend is that if you have a book that you're putting up for sale, put up the cover and 3 preview pages along with a link to where people can buy it and call people's attention to it. I've seen a lot of cartoonists and creators who like say, hey, my book's available for sale, but then don't tell you how to find it. So it's like, don't make your readers do extra work. Mm-hmm. Make it as easy as possible for them to find exactly what it is that you want them to find.
And for your specific problem where you're a writer and you are collaborating with a cartoonist, I find something that helps me a lot is separating social media into like different facets of my personality. which sounds very clinical, but like Facebook is for your personal circle, right? Tumblr is a little more professional. Your website is totally professional. Twitter is your garbage, like, but like your casual garbage, right? Your like your friendly personality. So for you as a writer, maybe Twitter would be better for you, right? Where you can exhibit more your personality, your writing ability. Tumblr might end up being a collaboration between you and your cartoonist, like a comic Twitter instead of a personal, I mean, comic Tumblr instead of a personal Tumblr. And then, yeah, maybe that would, you don't have to use Tumblr in the way you think you have to use it, you know?
I'd really recommend people using Facebook for self-promotional purposes. Like, I don't even have a personal Facebook page because I hate it, and I don't like Facebook. I have an author page, but as poorly designed it as it is, and as often as people can be shitty on it, I mean, there's a billion people on it. It's the number one traffic refer for almost every website by far. I mean, it refers, you know, 20 times the traffic of Twitter in most cases. Twitter has an illusion of like there being more people on it because you're constantly interacting and your friends are on it, and as like every cartoonist is on it seemingly all day because we're at our desk. But in reality, most people are just not on it as much. So it's kind of worth it. You know, it's worth investing in having a Facebook presence, I think.
Since I'm sorry.
I was going to say one quick thing. TweetDeck, which was an application that Twitter acquired. It's tweetdeck.twitter.com. They allow you to do timed posts. You can only do one image at a time through TweetDeck. But it will allow you to do something where if you wanted to do promotion over like a period of time, you can go in and pre-program all of your tweets and then schedule them when you want to come out. And there's another website called Clout, K-L-O-U-T. And they actually will allow you to not only time your tweets, but they'll actually recommend what the best time of the day to tweet is to get the maximum amount of exposure.
And they also show you how like effective it is too. Like how many other people in your network have redone. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry.
Oh, my other quick addendum is just that these websites also are changing very quickly, and like the atmosphere of one place, something will be trendy, and then like a year or two later, it's not as trendy. But overall advice is just to look at the artists who are a couple steps ahead of you in their career and see what they do with it. So just like follow people who are doing things that you would like to be doing. And learn from them. And I, for like all websites, for Kickstarter, that's a really good thing to do too. So don't try to reinvent the wheel every time on social media.
I definitely found a guy on OkCupid back in those days when I was single, and who had set up his profile like one of his characters. So it's very attractive. But yeah, it was interesting. It was, you know, for a writer too. It was just like you just need the photo and that's it, and then you can just go off. So I'm sorry. Next question. Take care. Oh, can you use the microphone? I'm sorry. We'll be less verbose this, or I can't make promises for you guys.
Is it working? Okay. What's like the number one like thing that you wish you had known when you started doing webcomics and comics in general?
That's a good question, but I don't know.
Maybe about organization or deadlines you made for yourself.
Tears are very salty.
So one thing I think is that even if you're starting a project and it feels like it's just a small fun thing that you're beginning, and you want to kind of treat it like that, like treat it casually, allow yourself to imagine what it would be like if you worked on it for a couple years. There are things where it's like original, like keeping your original pages or having your whatever files be just organized in a nice way, up to like having plans. Like if you start making a webcomic on the internet, have all the pages be the same size because maybe you want to put it in a book someday. Just like allow yourself to have those dreams, even if they don't really directly affect it.
So, and with that, saving things at 300 DPI in case it's in print instead of 70 or 600 or 600. Yeah, but at least.
I did 1200 DPI line art. It's a small.
Emily Carroll didn't save anything her first couple of years. It was all 72 DPI. Yeah,
there's a term in the tech world called technical debt, which is where you you basically pay for things later that for shortcuts that you do now, which is scanning everything at 72 DPI instead of 300, or actually 600 or higher. Never do 300. A lot of schools teach you to do 300. Do not do 300. It may never assume that what you're doing will not take off, because you will be surprised later on that you're like, well, I thought I would do this in red crayon and it would be awesome. And then you're like, suddenly you become like this huge cartoonist and you're like, I now have to redraw everything because I thought I'd be clever and use red crayon. So
don't knock crayon.
I'm not knocking crayon. I'm just saying.
It's expressive.
Yes. My kids love it.
I think my answer is a little sappier, but like, I really wish I hadn't spent so much of my time when I first started making comics for other people, or like what I thought other people wanted. And it's really easy to fall into if you're in school, or if you have people you want to impress, or if you're just starting and you kind of don't, you're still feeling things out. I think it's like a natural part of your growing process, but I think it's like, it's okay to, I keep saying like, it's okay to do this, it's okay to do that, but like, it's okay to do really self-indulgent work and just do work that you may think is cliched, but it's still gonna be original because like nobody can do work the way you can do it. So, and I think the very basic thing of like, if no one else likes this, then at least you did work you're proud of, right? I think that's super important.
I know my answer now. It's learning how to say no to things.
Yes.
Because especially if you're supporting yourself with freelance work. I mean, I quit a job and was just doing freelance work to support myself as a cartoonist. The idea being I would have more time to cartoon, which cannot be true if you're constantly accepting every job that, or, you know, and then also just like ruining your social life and relationships. And I was always just worried because I was living job to job and paycheck to paycheck that if I said no to something, you know, I'd never get another job. If I said no to an art director, they wouldn't call me back. And you eventually have to learn to do that for your own sanity, and even if you don't make a lot of money, really, if you give yourself more time to work on your own projects or be more selective with jobs, you know, that can come back on you in a lot of great ways.
Awesome. We've got time for one more question.
I just wanted one quick thing. Dropbox. I can't tell you how many times I've heard someone say, I lost my entire comic because the hard drive on my computer died. There are these things called Dropbox cloud storage. Highly recommend it. It's pretty inexpensive, and you're never going to lose anything.
Perfect. Young man, yes.
What do you do in your spare time?
Huh? What's spare time, guys?
Yeah, seriously.
Yeah.
I have kids. I don't have spare time.
Watch a lot of anime?
Yeah. Influence yourself?
Yeah.
Okay, we have time for... Sir, in the yellow, did you want to... You had a question?
Could you give us one big don't that you guys had? Like, you're like, don't ever do this again.
Oh. Cocaine, first of all.
Well, besides obvious, like, eating rocks
the,
and stuff.
The white elephant in the room.
Comic Sans.
You can get a lot of work done on cocaine, actually.
Comic Sans.
I'm just kidding.
I'd say, I think this tags along with what Aatmaja was saying, but don't make a comic because you think it will be popular on the internet, because it looks like something that you saw that was popular on the internet. Just don't. Just, like, you're better than that.
I think try to stray away from passive aggression and demanding things, like, with interactions here, personally, or on the internet.
Perfect. Be positive. Well, thank you guys. A round of applause for our panelists. Amazing.